animals that are in Atlanta.
Just in 3 years.
Minute. Hello. Okay. First of all, thank you for sharing this story, because like I think I can talk in behalf of everyone saying that it was very touching. I just finished to cry for just a second. And the first question was just to know, how did you reach them out, and how did you find Owen's family, and how was your relationship during the shooting? How did he relate to you, and if he found himself to be close to you, or if he found his privacy to be violated or something at the beginning? So just this.
Yeah. So I found the story because I'm very good friends with Owen's father, right. Ron Suskind. And Ron is a very famous author in America. He won the Pulitzer Prize. He writes big sort of nonfiction stories, usually about politics, the financial crisis, embeds himself in the White House. And all the time he was doing this, he was living this life, and I didn't know. And we met 15 years ago. We were working together at ABC News. He was the editor of the Wall Street Journal, a newspaper in America, and he was a correspondent on television, and I was one of his producers. And so I didn't know much about Owen, and then fast forward 15 years later, I met the filmmaker, and he came to me and pitched me this story. He said, I'm writing a book. This was a book that he wrote by the same name that I animated. And he said, I'm writing a book, and I think it would make a good film. So he pitched it to me, and I totally fell in love with the story, and I read the manuscript, and that's how I sort of started the journey.
Ho scoperto la storia perché sono un grande amico del padre. Lui è un famoso giornalista, ha vinto anche un premio Pulitzer. Solitamente scrive di politica, lavora anche alla Casa Bianca. L'ho conosciuto 15 anni fa quando lavoravamo ad ABC. Lui era l'editore del Wall Street Journal, ma a quel tempo non sapevo molto di Owen. Dopo 15 anni lui mi ha parlato del libro e mi ha spinto a fare un film, e ha detto potrebbe venire davvero un bel film, questa è una storia interessante, ed è così che è nata l'idea.
Okay, and then your second question was my relationship with Owen.
Yeah.
So when I first met Owen, which was I shot him, I filmed for a year with Owen and edited for a year, so it's about 2 years to make the film, but it's just 3 years ago because we've been on, the film was released at Sundance in January 2016. But when I first met Owen, it was a Valentine's Day dance at his school. And he was slow dancing with Emily, and I was so just moved by their relationship, and was just so good because he was so charismatic and handsome and charming, and I was just like, oh, he's an amazing character. He's a perfect character. But I was also uncomfortable because I hadn't met anyone with autism. I didn't know how to sort of communicate or interact with him. And it took me a while to figure out sort of, you know, to get beyond my own prejudices. And as I got to know Owen, I realized that it wasn't a disability, it was almost like that Owen had a deeper sense of understanding of the world than anyone I knew, because he had focused so much on the idea of myth and story. He was grown up watching these films, living on a diet of myth and story. These Disney films really are sort of classic stories that have been updated, you know, that basically Walt Disney ripped off and updated. And he's ripped off people like Hans Christian Andersen and various, and so So Owen was so wise, but it took me a while to get to know him and to get over my own prejudices about autism. So for me, it was important in the film that the audience takes the same journey, where in the beginning of the film you're uncomfortable because he's talking to himself and pacing around. You don't know what he's saying and you're uncomfortable. But slowly, you're taken into Owen's reality and you are transformed to see the world through his eyes and his point of view. And as you go deeper into his reality, you are transformed and you not only understand him, you understand that he has a special gift and understanding of the world. And the journey that I took in making the film was a journey that I wanted the audience to take.
Thank you.
Ok, ci sono voluti oltre 2 anni per realizzare il film, che alla fine è uscito il 21 gennaio del 2016. Quando per la prima volta ho incontrato Owen, si trattava del Valentine's Day, cioè il giorno di San Valentino, e l'ho visto che stava ballando con Emily al ballo della scuola. Sono rimasto molto colpito dalla loro relazione, perché appunto è stato fantastico vedere come si relazionava con le altre persone. All'inizio però non ero a mio agio, perché non sapevo come comunicare, non avevo dei pregiudizi nei confronti delle persone autistiche, ne avevo conosciute ben poche. Però subito realizzai appunto che Owen era in un certo senso meglio degli altri, perché aveva un modo particolare di vedere la realtà e si concentrava molto di più sulle cose che faceva. I film della Disney lo hanno aiutato moltissimo, perché in realtà sono dei film classici, diciamo, che parlano della realtà, e lui parlava attraverso questi film. Un attimo solo. Sì, il mio messaggio era quello appunto di far vivere al pubblico lo stesso viaggio, lo stesso percorso, perché bisognava trovarsi in una situazione appunto non piacevole all'inizio, bisognava far capire qual era il suo stato iniziale per poi far capire il cambiamento, e quindi lo spettatore doveva vedere il film attraverso i suoi occhi, doveva vedere la sua storia appunto attraverso i suoi occhi per poterlo capire. Quindi c'è una sorta di viaggio che accompagna lo spettatore nella storia di Owen.
In the film, the only crises, the only moments of crisis are seen in retrospective, like when he was when he was a child, and there are crises during his present times, but are handled very good. I mean, it's very positive movie, but during the filming, or even before the filming, when we met him, there was ever a moment of real crisis, real, you know, anger or something that couldn't be handled even by his parents or something.
Yeah. Well, the biggest crisis in Owen's life was when Emily broke up with him. And because Owen has autism, it's difficult when you fall in love for the first time. It's difficult for any of us when when someone breaks our heart. It's very difficult. But for someone like Owen, who has autism, whose his emotions are heightened, it was very, very difficult for him, very emotional for the family. And it was a crisis moment for him. Because Owen has autism, and because Owen sort of reacts in a Disney way, he displays, you know, oh my, you know, like the way his movement, you know, you may think because it's like a cartoon character, but it's really emotional for him. And so it was also a moment of crisis for the parents, for Ron and Cornelia, who Cornelia, she cries many times in the film, because Owen, this is as much a coming of age story as it is, you know, it was important to follow Owen in the present day as he becomes a man, and he goes through the things that we all go through: graduation, falling in love, breaking up, and moving on to his own. And all of those points were really difficult because the reason Cornelia, when he, for instance, when he moves into his apartment for the first time, the reason Cornelia is crying in the scene with the therapist is because she says Owen is not ready and he will never be able to live alone. And all of those moments for the family were really tough. And even for Walt, his brother, who had to come to terms in the film for the first time with being a sibling of someone living with autism, where you are forgotten because all of the resources, all of the attention of the parents go to Owen. And he sat on the pier that day in the film, and he's emotional because it is so hard for kids, siblings, and they never get acknowledged. They never get the chance to really express how they feel. And because of that, because of Walt, he has started an organization for siblings of children with autism. And now, him and Owen together travel around the country talking to families and talking about the issues of the brothers and the sisters of people with autism.
Allora, il momento di più grande crisi è stato sicuramente il momento della rottura con Emily. Sappiamo tutti quanto può essere difficile essere in amore e avere appunto il cuore spezzato, però per Owen è sicuramente molto più complicato, come abbiamo visto. Anche la famiglia appunto ha avuto grandissimi problemi ad aiutarlo e a aiutare a fargli passare questo momento. Abbiamo visto lui come reagisce in un modo Disney, diciamo, un po' come in un cartone animato, ma in realtà questo è solo il suo modo di esprimere le emozioni. Abbiamo visto appunto quanto la famiglia provi ad aiutarlo e quanti pianti ci siano anche nel film, oltre a quelli che non sono stati mostrati, perché ovviamente è molto difficile per loro stargli accanto in questi momenti. E loro lo hanno accompagnato in tutti i suoi step, gli step più importanti della sua vita, che sono stati appunto la laurea, l'innamoramento, eccetera, eccetera. Abbiamo visto appunto la madre piangere durante la seduta con la terapista perché appunto capisce quanto siano gravi i problemi di Owen e capisce il fatto che Owen avrà per sempre bisogno di attenzioni e non sarà mai diciamo in grado di vivere da solo. Bisogna appunto fare i conti con questa realtà, come fa anche il fratello, appunto come fa Walt, che appunto ha una vita molto difficile anche per il fatto di non ricevere le stesse attenzioni di Owen, tant'è che Walt, proprio per diciamo superare questo problema, ha anche creato un'organizzazione al riguardo, appunto per i fratelli e per i familiari che hanno appunto il bisogno e la necessità di occuparsi di familiari autistici.
Owen autism is less serious than others. Could you make a movie on an autistic boy who, at Owen's age, still did not say a word of accomplishment meaning?
I'm trying to understand. Did you say Owen's autism is less than others?
Che io lavoro in una cucina anche con dei bambini autistici, quindi ce n'è uno in particolare che non ha 12 anni e non dice una parola, è condannato.
Okay, yes, to do with
Owen never spoke. Owen was also nonverbal and could not speak. Owen was the most severe autistic case. He not only could not speak, he had he couldn't communicate with other people. He couldn't be in school. Cornelia had to homeschool him in school. What's remarkable is that the Susskinds, especially Cornelia, really did not give up. She found a pathway to all and through Disney animated films, but this idea that you can connect to someone with autism through their affinity, we call it affinity, which is their passion. Many autistic people have something they connect to, and this has become now a sort of global idea because of the book and the film. So when Owen speaks in France, it's the first international conference on autism to discuss affinity therapy, which is the idea that you connect to someone, you find a pathway into the person through their affinity and draw them out. And now, Cambridge, Simon Baron Cohen, who is the brother of Sacha Baron Cohen, Borat, is the leading neurologist in Cambridge. And John Gabrielli, the leading neurologist at MIT, and Stanford have started the first study of affinity therapy in the world. And Ron has started an organization that is now, he has addressed the National Institutes of Health and the US Congress. And this is this whole new idea, a way to connect. And that was because they didn't give up, the Suskinds.
Anche Owen all'inizio non parlava ed era sicuramente una fase molto grave, uno degli stati più gravi di autismo. La cosa straordinaria però appunto è stato il fatto che la madre non ha mai mollato, non ha smesso di aiutarlo, lo ha aiutato appunto con la scuola, ha fatto homeschooling, cioè l'ha aiutato a casa. Hanno quindi trovato il modo di trovare appunto delle affinità con lui, delle connessioni, in questo caso attraverso i film Disney. Quando lui per la prima volta parla in francese, quell'evento rappresenta la prima volta in cui a livello internazionale si è parlato appunto di queste nuove teorie, diciamo, sull'aiuto alle persone autistiche, riguardo appunto l'affinità, trovare un punto di connessione. A Cambridge, al MIT, a Stanford sono partiti i primi studi appunto proprio su queste teorie, tra cui appunto ha partecipato anche il fratello di Sacha Baron Cohen, e queste teorie stanno avendo una grandissima attenzione, tant'è che se ne è parlato anche appunto al congresso degli Stati Uniti, insomma ha avuto una grande risonanza questa nuova opportunità di studio e di aiuto per le persone autistiche.
Well, I would like to ask you, I'm here.
Hi.
How much do you think that Owen's father's social status, or better, his job, helped Owen to achieve his successful results? Just because I'm thinking that he had a lot of possibilities also to know a lot of people that other autistic person people
Zero. Owen's father, when Owen was diagnosed with autism, was poor, made no money. He was a young journalist right out of school, and journalists don't make very much money. Now they have money because he's written many books, and he's very self-made. But it had nothing to do with their money, but it had to do with their passion and their love for their son, because they refused. Any of the therapists told them not to let him watch Disney, not to encourage him to watch these films, but to restrict it. And they went against that because they realized that that was a way to connect with him. And they went against everything they were told, and it was a miracle that they were able to figure out a way. And that any person, any parent can do, it just takes dedication and love and a passion for a way to connect with your kids. And I always say the film is much about love and family, and that's what really is made Owen the young man he is today, is this love of these incredible parents and his family.
Non ha mai inferito per nulla. Il padre di Owen, quando gli è stato diagnosticato con l'autismo, era molto povero, era un giovane giornalista che era appena uscito dalla scuola, e i giovani giornalisti non fanno tutti questi soldi. Ora sì, sono benestanti perché lui ha pubblicato molti libri e ha fatto successo, ma si è fatto da solo. Quindi il film ci fa capire che non ha realmente a che fare con i soldi, ma con la passione. Quando la terapia gli dava di far vedere il film Disney al loro figlio, loro non insistivano, hanno voluto continuare a provare per questa strada, ed è stato sostanzialmente un miracolo, hanno trovato il loro modo di comunicare con il figlio anche quando questo gli era stato sconsigliato. Quindi ci vuole passione, e il film ci fa capire che non è appunto il punto centrale di tutta la questione, sia l'amore e la famiglia, in quanto appunto Owen abbia un padre che si è dedicato a lui con tutto l'amore possibile.
Vorrei fare una domanda in italiano.
Sì.
Ok, intanto volevo ringraziarlo perché mi ha molto emozionata questo film. Anche io mi trovo a relazionare con persone che hanno il problema dell'autismo, e la similarità che ho riscontrato con questo ragazzo è che in un certo senso per rapportarsi con una persona autistica si deve ritrovare la propria dimensione più vera, spontanea, bambina, ma in senso positivo. E secondo me nel fare un film su una persona affetta da autismo si deve fare la stessa cosa a livello registico, e secondo me questo film ci riesce, e riesce ad integrare l'animazione e linguaggi anche molto differenti. E volevo, secondo me ce l'ha fatta, ma volevo sapere qual è il processo che ha utilizzato per riuscire a fare questo.
Well, I think it's true. Owen is a pure person. He cannot tell a lie. He cannot act. He cannot, even making the film, I say, Owen, I didn't get the shot of you walking through the door. Can you walk through the door again? He's like, why would I walk through the door again? I already walked through the door. Like, you can't. Which is both a challenge and also very beautiful, because Owen is such a pure person, like you said. The challenge for me was really started well before this film. It started a couple of films ago when I made Music by Prudence. I lived in an orphanage of children with severe physical disabilities in Zimbabwe, in Africa, in one of the worst environments and countries of the world. And what I learned making that film was that the thing that was most important to all of these kids, and Prudence doesn't have arms or legs, but what was most important to her was independence and giving her a voice. So for me, the way to understand Owen was to let Owen speak for himself, was to give Owen a voice and to get inside his head. And I used a number of filmmaking techniques to do that. And I can tell you all, I'll stop and I'll tell you how I did that.
Penso che sia vero quello che hai detto. Owen è una persona pura, non è in grado di mentire, non può fare nulla di finto, come ad esempio è successo durante le riprese, in un momento in cui appunto non avevo registrato l'ingresso in una stanza, gli ho detto potresti entrare, e mi ha detto no, ma perché dovrei farlo, l'ho appena fatto. In realtà la sfida nel raccontare storie di questo tipo per me è partita con Music by Prudence, che è un film che mi ha portato in un orfanotrofio di bambini con gravissime disabilità fisiche in Zimbabwe, e appunto si incentrava su Prudence, che è una ragazza che non ha arti, ma non ha né braccia né gambe, ma che si concentra principalmente sulla sua libertà e sul suo desiderio di autonomia. Quello che volevo fare con questo film era dare ad Owen la possibilità di esprimersi, cioè far capire qual è la sua visione del mondo e dare voce appunto a questa persona.
So the reason the Susskinds wanted to make this film is because Owen came to them and said, people look past him, people don't see him for who he is. And he wanted people to know him for who he is. So that was my directive, is to really get people, the audience, you to understand. So Owen is the only person in the film that looks directly into the camera. I use a camera invented by Earl Morris, very famous documentarian in America, and called an Interitron. And this is a camera with Owen is looking at me, interviewing him on a television screen. I'm in another room, and he's looking at me on the screen, and the camera is behind the screen. So Owen could not necessarily look, talk to me, if we were just sitting in a traditional interview setup, but a screen, he spent his life looking at a television screen. He spent his life. And so I spent a week going through Owen's life with a switch, AB switch. I would ask him a question, and then I would go to a Disney clip that really was part of his development and part of his story. So I would go through the story of his life through the story of Disney clips. Because that was the language that he understood. So I would ask him a question and show him a clip, and he would interact. And when you see Owen in the movie interacting, mouthing the words to the screen, he's interacting directly to the audience. And so you are, in a sense, inside the Disney clip, and you're, in a sense, inside his head. And then about a third of the way through the movie, you are ready to go deeper inside Owen's head, and that's when you go to the Land of the Lost Sidekicks, which is a story that Owen wrote and created, and is the last chapter in the book. And the sidekicks are always with Owen. They are his advisors in life. And they're with him, and when he's talking and mumbling, talking, self-talking, he's doing all the voices because he believes he sees all the Disney films at once, and they're always talking to him. So he's always in dialogue and advising him in his life.
Il film si concentra principalmente sul fatto che Owen non è visto per quello che è. La famiglia mi ha chiesto proprio questo, di realizzare un film che facesse vedere Owen per quello che realmente è. Infatti io volevo realizzarlo, volevo far vedere la sua realtà. Infatti Owen è l'unico personaggio che guarda in macchina. In realtà, tramite un escamotaggio, appunto, in realtà Owen non guardava direttamente nei miei occhi perché c'era una telecamera che era dietro uno schermo, quindi lui guardava semplicemente in camera e io lo vedevo in uno schermo. In realtà, appunto, lo schermo è un po' la metafora della sua vita, lui è sempre passato una vita schermata, appunto, dietro qualcosa che lo bloccava. Quando io facevo appunto delle domande, gli chiedevo qualcosa e poi andavo a cercare magari Disney per farmi capire, perché appunto quello è il modo più semplice e più diretto per farsi capire da Owen. E quindi quando sei dentro la clip, quando io ti faccio vedere la clip nel film, in quel momento sei anche dentro la sua testa, perché lui è così che ragiona. Ed è questo il collegamento anche con il cartone finale. Tutta la parte appunto disegnata e animata, in realtà ci esprime quello che è dentro la sua testa. I sidekicks, che sono appunto gli abitanti, in realtà sono sempre con lui, lui addirittura parla con gli abitanti, e quindi il film e soprattutto la parte animata e quindi Disney volevano far capire quello che avveniva dentro la testa di Owen.
I have the movie starts when he was near the equation, and you describe his childhood, and I want to know how you decide to put the end of the story.
when you decide to say, okay, I told enough about all?
Well, it was a natural sort of arc to the film, because Owen was about to go through a very transitional year of his life. He was in love, he was going to graduate school, and he was going to move on his own. So that's a natural arc. We don't know what's going to happen, if he's going to be able to live on his own. We don't know what's going to happen the first night he spends alone in his life. We don't know if he's going to succeed or fail. And we have big moments that are universal, that everyone has in their life. Everyone graduates, hopefully. Everyone falls in love, hopefully. And everyone becomes independent. Everyone will move away from their parents and live on their own, and has to face the world on their own. So what I wanted it to be is a universal, classic coming of age story. And so it was a natural ending of him as an adult. And it was important that it wasn't a perfect ending, that we don't know. It's uncertain, his future. You know, without his parents, the role of his brother, that it was uncertain, because life is uncertain. But we know in the sort of ending montage of all the Disney, that he always has his sidekicks who are wise. The sidekicks in life guide the hero on his journey. And this film's a hero's journey. It's Owen's hero's journey. And they guide him, and they help the hero to fulfill his destiny.
In realtà il processo è stato molto naturale, perché come avete visto era un anno di grande transizione, quindi quello che ho fatto vedere rappresentava un momento di grande transizione nella sua vita. Voleva rappresentare appunto l'arco naturale della vita. Infatti noi non sappiamo cosa succederà dopo, non vi faccio vedere cosa è successo la prima notte in cui è stato a casa da solo, non sappiamo se ci farà, se fallirà o se avrà altre crisi. Noi sappiamo appunto che fa le cose che fanno tutti quanti che si innamorano, tutti quanti vanno al college, tutti quanti vanno a vivere da sola. Infatti era esattamente questo che volevo far vedere, una storia universale, classica, di transizione, di cambiamento e di passaggio della matura. Non c'è una fine perfetta, non c'è certezza, non si sa quello che avverrà dopo la fine del film, come nella vita, ma sappiamo sicuramente che avrà sempre al suo fianco i suoi aiutanti, i suoi sidekicks, come in realtà li abbiamo tutti i nostri aiutanti che ci supportano durante i momenti difficili di cambiamento.
Come sono state realizzate le parti animali? Perché sono guardato direttamente tu o c'era un animatore che le ha realizzate?
By myself, wow. So, The Land of the Lost Sidekicks is Owen's story. It's his autobiography that he is constantly still writing. He creates the villains. He met Fuzz Butch in the film. He creates the villains that correspond to the challenges he has in his life. And this is the last chapter in the book. And for me, I was always going to bring that to life through animation. It is, Owen identifies only with hand-drawn animation because of the emotion of the artist on paper, as opposed to computer-generated animation. Not Pixar, classic hand-drawn animation. So I went to France, to Paris, to McGuff, a company that the French do amazing tradition of classic 2D animation. So I went to McGuff, this company that is, they did Despicable Me, and The Lorax, and The Minions, and various films. But Philippe, the owner of this company, is an incredible character who lives on a boat on the Seine, and basically looks like the guy from Despicable Me. Like, he's like, it's based on him. And he is brilliant. And he personally took on this task and put together a team of 15 young French animators who hand drew the animation in the film for 1.5 years. Hand-drawn animation is very, it's very time-consuming. Each cell, everything is hand-drawn and created by this team of French animators led by Philippe and Mathieu, this guy Mathieu, who was the lead, producer, and Olivier, who was the lead artist. And they were rewarded because during the Oscar season, they won the Annie Award, which is the Animation Oscars. And it was pretty amazing because Owen accepted the award. 2,000 animators in Los Angeles. You can watch it on Facebook, on our Facebook page. He made the most amazing speech because he talked emotionally about how they gave him a voice, these animators. And that was an amazing moment because all those animators were in tears. They didn't know what they do and that their work could change someone's life.
Allora, la parte animata costituisce sostanzialmente l'autobiografia di Owen. Lui l'ha scritta da sola ed è in continuo cambiamento, continua a creare dei personaggi che esprimono sostanzialmente quelle che sono le sfide della sua vita. Lui riesce a portarsi solo con disegni fatti a mano. Infatti, per far capire questa cosa, mi sono recato in Francia, a Parigi, e sono andato da questa compagnia che è la MEGAF, una compagnia che fa animazioni in 2D, e appunto il capo è una persona molto particolare che vive in una barca e sembra molto il personaggio principale di The Spirit. Ha creato un team di 15 animatori che hanno lavorato per un anno e mezzo appunto a questo progetto, e hanno fatto tutto a mano, e quindi sappiamo quanto può essere lungo e appunto anche più faticoso fare tutto quanto a mano, ma era l'unico modo per esprimere appunto l'interiorità di Owen. Questi animatori, tra cui ricordo appunto Philippe, Mathieu e Olivier, hanno vinto anche poi l'Emmy, che è stato ritirato da Owen, e nel momento in cui appunto ha preso questo premio, ha fatto un discorso che è stato pazzesco, è stato incredibile, e potete anche trovarlo su Facebook, su YouTube, e questo discorso fantastico ha fatto veramente piangere gli animatori che in quel momento hanno realizzato quanto la loro opera potesse aver cambiato una persona e comunque potesse aver comunicato qualcosa al pubblico.
We released a separate film, short animated, fully animated film, The Land of the Lost Sidekicks, as a separate film, which we premiered at the New York Film Festival, and you can watch it on iTunes, and it's narrated by Owen, it's called The Land of the Lost Sidekicks.
Abbiamo anche lasciato un film a parte che è proprio tutto incentrato sulla parte animata e verrà presentato appunto al New York Film Festival. Lo si può trovare su iTunes ed è qualcosa di molto particolare, anche perché viene narrato dallo stesso Owen.
What was the role of Disney in this movie? I mean, did they know what you were doing with Owen and their films, or?
Yes. Well, they didn't know in the beginning. I went to Disney, and I basically pitched the idea that I wanted to do this film, because I couldn't do it without the rights to all these Disney films. Disney is very famous for not allowing anyone to use any of their footage. They're infamous for that. It was a process that took me about a year and a half. I had a connection to the president of Disney because he's on the board of the Sundance Film Festival, and I'm on the board of the Sundance Film Festival alumni board, different boards. He's on the big, powerful board. I'm on the little, funny board. And so I went to him, to his office at the Disney lot, and I was very intimidated because the lot, the Disney studio lot in Burbank, the headquarters of Disney is like it's like a building with the Roman pillars, but the pillars are the seven dwarfs. And it's just this massive, so you think you're in Rome, but it's like, you know, it's like an Amma. And so you go into, and it's so crazy, you go into his office, and he has this sort of outer office with all his assistants and stuff, and then this massive office filled with art and this big desk, and he flew over the desk and he said, "Why you? Why should I let you have the keys to the kingdom?" And I said, you know, it was like going to the great powerful Oz, and I said, I thought this was important, and he liked it. And he said, "I'm going to help you navigate through the whole world of Disney." So he put together all the heads of every department of Disney: marketing, legal, animation, every business affairs, the whole team. And he said, "I want you to present your vision, your dream of the film to the entire team of Disney." Many of these people who, Disney is the biggest media empire in the world. And so these people have their own empires, and they don't even necessarily know each other. And I took them on a journey, showing them footage, home movie footage of Owen. I shot Disney Club. And I took them on a journey through the film, and by the time I was done with my presentation, they were in tears. And they said, "We want to stand in your way."
Sì, la Disney si arriva e sostanzialmente sono andato da Disney e gli ho proposto la mia idea, ma c'è, sappiamo che appunto la Disney è una delle case che ha più, diciamo, più restia a lasciare i propri diritti e a dare l'autorizzazione dei propri diritti. C'è voluto quasi un anno per mettermi appunto di ottenere questi diritti, io però alla fine l'ho ottenuti perché avevo una conoscenza con il presidente della Disney che appunto si basava sulla nostra presenza al Sundance, tutti e due eravamo nella giuria del Sundance Film Festival, anche se lui era molto più importante di me. Sono andato poi appunto nel loro quartiere generale, in questo palazzo gigante, sono andato nel suo ufficio, che era anche questo gigante con decine di assistenti, e lui mi ha chiesto: "Perché tu vuoi chiarire il mio regno? Perché dovrei scegliere te?" E sostanzialmente gli ho fatto capire l'importanza del mio progetto, gli ho detto che ci credevo, e lui alla fine ha deciso di aiutarmi e mi ha dato accesso appunto a tutti i team della Disney, appunto al team legale, al team di marketing, mi ha dato comunque accesso a tutti gli archivi, e noi sappiamo appunto che Disney è sicuramente il più grande impero di media appunto mediale del mondo, quindi insomma è stato un grande progetto. Ho preso queste persone, le ho portate, diciamo, nel mio viaggio, gli ho spiegato tutto quanto, gli ho spiegato la missione, e alla fine erano letteralmente in lacrime, e quindi si sono dimostrati molto, molto promessi ad aiutarmi.
Allora, a un certo punto i genitori di Owen dicono che loro non sono psicologi, ma si sono trovati a doverlo essere. E nel corso del film gli chiedono molto spesso come si sente, che cosa prova, anche il fratello, e volevo sapere se è una cosa che hanno sempre fatto o se c'è stato un intervento anche comunque registico nel chiedergli appunto come si sentisse, che cosa provasse rispetto alle varie situazioni.
Well, the whole book, Life Animated, is about the journey of Ron and Cornelia and their story. So there was a best-selling book that was about their story. So it was in great detail because it's a book about how they had to figure out how to find a way to their son and. No, they're not psychologists, they're just regular people, but they are both really brilliant and really loving parents, and they really just had to find their own way and sort through a lot of information and misinformation and that was something that I learned, about their journey and what they went through from the book. So I had that knowledge to, ask them questions and get them to tell me that part of the story, which is in the movie shown in flashbacks, in this sort of line drawing animated flashback sequences.
Tutto il libro, Life Animated, si incentra appunto sul percorso dei genitori che non sono psicologi, sono delle persone normali, ma sono delle persone brillanti che amano il loro figlio e hanno cercato, appunto, hanno trovato il loro modo di informarsi e di relazionarsi poi appunto con il figlio, con questo nuovo metodo appunto innovativo. Io ovviamente sapevo questo aspetto, ho fatto delle domande in modo da appunto farmi dire di più da questo punto di vista, ma comunque è un aspetto che è nato, spontaneamente da loro.
So, what does Owen think of the movie when he saw it the first time?
Owen saw the film the first time in my office in New York and with Ron, and it was just him and Ron watching the rough cut, called rough cut of the film, not the final color corrected cut. And Owen came running out of the room and he hugged me, and which is very uncharacteristic. And he said, "I love it," and then we all cried. Cornelia and Walt saw the film for the first time at the premiere at Sundance Film Festival in front of 1,000 people. It was, as you can imagine, incredibly emotional for them. And then they had to come in front of the audience and do a Q&A in tears, emotional. It was. I don't even remember that premiere because it was sort of out of body, the whole thing, so it was sort of crazy, so I have very little memory of what happened. Sort of like the Oscars, I can barely remember that.
Owen ha visto il film per la prima volta nel mio ufficio di New York con i padri, con nonna, era la prima versione, era ancora la versione con la color correction e insomma la versione finale, ma quando l'artista ha iniziato a urlare a correre per la stanza mi ha abbracciato e mi ha detto lo amo, tutti quanti abbiamo pianto. Cornelia e Walt invece l'hanno visto per la prima volta a Sundance di fronte a migliaia di persone e anche per loro quindi è stato davvero molto emozionante e poi hanno dovuto anche sottoporsi a un Q&A, a una serie di domande quando erano ancora in lacrime, quindi è stata un'esperienza molto particolare per tutti quanti e in realtà appunto non ricordo bene com'è stata quella sera perché c'erano tantissime emozioni e quindi non ricordo perfettamente, un po' come gli Oscar, diciamo, non ricordo esattamente quello che è successo.
Can I ask you guys a question? How many of you are filmmakers?
Quanti di voi realizzano film?
One. Or rather, okay, aspiring filmmakers.
Aspiranti.
And you're all students in film school here?
Studenti di cinema.
And how many of you want to make documentaries?
Quanti per il documentario?
You know, so I didn't go to film school. I went to journalism school. I was a journalist before I was a filmmaker. And I worked for CNN and for ABC, all the big networks. I worked for the New York Times. We had the New York Times had a Discovery and New York Times had a channel together. And and then I became totally disillusioned with journalism because I thought the real story is being told in documentary. And documentary films were telling real truths, and the mainstream media, in America at least, was not telling the truth, the whole story, and all the interesting work was a dream. And so I left disillusioned from CNN, I quit my job, and I went to work for Comedy Central. And because Comedy Central, the comedy channel, was covering politics with Al Franken, who is a senator in the U.S. Senate. And now, before that, he was a comedian, and Arianna Huffington, who was a Huffington Post, who is a right wing commentator. She was actually right wing, actually left wing. But so we with Chris Rock, Dennis Miller. The guys who started Seinfeld, the writers from Saturday Night Live, we covered politics and we were the precursor to Jon Stewart, and we covered politics in a real way. And it was so refreshing to me, and then I was so became addicted to satire and political satire, then I went to work for Michael Moore, and I became his producer. And we produced a series for called TV Nation for Fox and for the BBC. And then I produced Louis Theroux, who is now a big BBC, does documentaries for the BBC, but then was a just starting out. And that's how I got into sort of documentary film. Just a little background.
Io non sono andato a una scuola di cinema, ho seguito la scuola di giornalismo ed ho iniziato appunto con gli Andy Network, ho lavorato per la CNN, per l'ABC, per il New York Times, che al tempo era appunto un canale insieme a Discovery. Ben presto mi sono ricreduto riguardo il mondo del giornalismo perché appunto ho iniziato a capire che le vere storie vengono raccontate con i documentari e i network spesso non dicono tutta la verità e quindi mi sono licenziato dalla CNN e sono andato a lavorare per Comedy Central, ho lavorato insieme a Chris Rock e a un sacco di altre persone con i quali abbiamo creato un vero spazio di satira politica, abbiamo parlato di politica in maniera reale, ci siamo concentrati sui reali problemi e questo mi ha portato a lavorare anche con Michael Moore come suo produttore, del quale ha prodotto appunto una serie TV che poi è stata questa, insegnando sulla BBC, e questo è un po' come mi sono avvicinato, diciamo, al mondo del documentario.
Ma possiamo magari parlare fuori, perché devono allestire per la serata di la cerimonia di premiazione.
Well, thank you guys for coming.